Time with each other, Lord, and also to Richard Howard is here from the Miss President, who will speak to our guests. We just thank God for what he had for us. But he never let us, he never forsake us. That your mercies are new every day. We just worship you, God. Give us thanks to you, this time to you, this prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys, want to stand? We will enter into worship. We will song.
Sign up sheet for the different things they need help with, and I'm sure if you you want to help with more than what's already there, you can, right, Dean?
Right.
All right, so if there's not a line and somebody's already signed up, go ahead and just put them in there, because we can always use as much help as possible. And this is a hand-in-hand note before service. It says we would like to have baked goods for sale, so if you can bring them Wednesday evening to Bible study or youth group, or Thursday during the day, anytime during the day, Danny, or after night. All right, you'll be here all day to bring those in, and we'll have those for sale as well as the hamburgers, hot dogs, chips, drinks. So it's going to be an awesome time. I saw the Sheepbirds been announced as part of the tour for the Thursday nights for the summer. So a lot of people are finding out about it. I'm going to go ahead and, Danny, you want to go ahead and skip the next slide, go to the next one? Well, go to the next slide. That's the next one. There we go. That's Danny's display. And there's pictures that you worked with nobody to work on it, right?
And the Grand Prix that I don't have anymore.
And the Grand Prix he doesn't have anymore, which is a pretty nice looking car.
I wish I had it back.
I wish I had my dad's 65 Chevelle.
No.
But that all said, this weekend is an important weekend. And Danny, go ahead and go to the next slide. Take this time to stand up and read one.
Thank you. There's a lamb that is in the
Take time to remember this weekend. let us also remember what Jesus has done for us, the sacrifices he made. Father, as we hear your message this morning, let us truly hear it and act on it. And use the words that you've given to guide our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. Remember, sometimes that's hard. Sometimes we have memory loss. As a few of you may have noticed this morning, I do so good on names. Faces, I'm good. I know where I've seen you. I know how I know you. I'm not always going to remember your name. And that bothers me to a certain extent. Because you know what? Like I'm looking at a blank page. That's an eye. There's diseases out there that rob us of our memories. The most pronounced one is Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's is a severe form of dementia that eventually leads to death. And I'm not sure who it's harder on. The person who's suffering or the caregivers. Now for me, when I go back to memories, I can remember being at the cemetery in Boxholm, not Sweden but Iowa, there's a little Swedish community over north of Boone. And I remember and the cemetery is 1 mile east of town on a gravel road. And I can remember that it was a huge gathering. You wouldn't know this town was just a few hundred people. I think every one of them came out. Soldiers would line up and they would aim their guns into the air and you hear the crack of that rifle. And that shot went off. I still have, I don't remember how old I was, I still have one of the shells. One of those memories I couldn't just toss away because it reminded me of so much. In fact, I'm a student of history. I love history. One of my favorite time periods was World War II. In fact, I was consumed by it to the point that every book that my mother would buy me was something to do with World War II. And usually not the fictional stuff, the real history books. One of my favorite figures from that time frame was not everybody's. But his name, he went by Blood and Guts. Most of you may know who that is. It was Lieutenant General George S. Patton. And yep, I sat and watched that several hour long movie back in the early 70s when it came out. Well, one thing that about him was that he was also a student of history. Now, he believed some strange things. He believed in mere incarnation. He believed that he had been in battles throughout the course of history and just reincarnated into a different leader each time. But one thing that he did say is that if we don't pay attention to our history, then we're going to make the same mistakes our ancestors made. And we can break out of that cycle by learning from, not just from our mistakes, but from their mistakes. Now forgetting is always due to memory loss. I think some of mine is due to the fact that sometimes we don't pay attention. Sometimes we're consumed by everything that's going on right now or what's coming up in the future that we don't take time to think about where we've been. And other times it's just probably because we have way too much. You ever got way too much going on? It sure feels like it from time to time. Forgetting can also be embarrassing. The embarrassing part of that probably to me comes when I call you by your wrong name.
So I can get the name tag.
You don't have one to sign up or one in the end that I sent. It helps me out a lot. But that brings me to the memorials and how they help us to remember. Now, Memorial Day, for a lot of folks, is just another day off. Time to fire up the grill and have a cold one. But this is how the Veterans, or the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs defines Memorial Day. Memorial Day, which is observed on the last Monday of May, commemorates the men and women who died while in the military service. In observance of the holiday, many people visit cemeteries and memorials, and volunteers often place American flags on each grave site at national cemeteries. The National Moment of Remembrance takes place at 3 p.m. local time. My neighbor is a veteran. I know that because he took a lot of time to put in a full-size flagpole. He flies his flag night and day, and he has it lit. Part of flag anyway. And then he also has a silhouette cutout of a soldier down in prayer stance with his rifle. Memorial Day evokes lots of emotional things. I saw quite a few teary eyes after that video earlier. Now, Memorial Day is not a religious holiday. It's not. And that's okay. What it does do is it reminds us to remember. We set apart a day and a specific time for remembrance. And it goes to why it is so important to us here at Relic Life that we teach and preach God's Word so that it is not forget, so that we remember it. Now, failure to remember can lead us down that dangerous path. You could fail to remember from which turn to take and end up lost. In the case of our soldiers, you could fail to remember where that landmine was and stuff. I was recently reading about a soldier who passed away. He was a lieutenant in the army that he served. And there wasn't anything remarkable about this gentleman, other than the fact that in 1944, he was given an order to go to a jungle on a Philippine island and keep watch. He kept watch until 1974 when he walked out of that jungle and surrendered, not knowing that it had been nearly three decades since the end of the war. He went home a hero. Not remembering can lead us into spiritual danger. It can lead us to faith issues. We don't remember what God has taught us or what God teaches us. It can begin breaking down the foundations of our faith and then our relationship with God. The Old Testament is full of these. Judges, chapter 3, verse 7. The Israelites did evil in the Lord's sight. They forgot about the Lord their God, and they served the images of Baal and the Asherah poles. And it doesn't take long And then all of a sudden they're oppressed. And then they remember, they're in trouble. Hey God, help us out. That was verse 7 that I read. Verse 12. We go right back at it. Once again, the Israelites did evil in the Lord's sight. Again, they forgot about all that he had done for them. And it's beginning in Genesis and running all the way through the Old Testament. Even in the New Testament, they aren't remembering God. It's been said that the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. So the Israelites kept going and serving Baal, and worshiping Baal, and worshiping the Asherah poles. Then they would come back whining and crying to God, wanting him to save them from their problems. And he would. God is a good God. But they never forget it. And it was oh. Pick up the Old Testament and you read through it. Today I'm reading my devotions. Solomon, who was told by God in a vision that he did everything that his father did and kept his faith in him and did all that he was asked to do, that his dynasty would be set for eternity. Yet Solomon, even though he was the wisest man in the world, had lust. And he saw these women from other countries who worshiped Baal and the Asherah poles and their other gods. And he would marry them, and ultimately in his old age, he started worshiping those same idols. And the cycle continued. Remembering is important. Throughout the Bible, we read about the importance of remembering. And whether good or bad, remembering is notated in the Bible. And this is just the version that I was looking at, 267 times. It's important for us to remember. But just like then, today our culture makes it hard for us to stay focused on God. Just turn on the TV. Just go to the movies. Turn on the radio to almost any channel. Walk down the street, look at a billboard. It's almost the sense that our culture has made us spiritually ADD. Oh, look. But there are verses in the Bible that speak specifically to why we need to remember. That we're called on to remember. Moses tells us in Deuteronomy 8, verses 1 through 5, be careful to obey all the commands I have given you today. Then you will live and multiply, and you will enter and occupy the land the Lord swore to give your ancestors. Remember how the Lord your God led you through the wilderness for these 40 years, humbling you and testing you to prove your character and to find out whether or not you would obey his commands. Yes, he humbled you by letting you go hungry and then feeding you manna, a food previously unknown to you and your ancestors. He did it to teach you that people do not live by bread alone, rather, we live by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. For all these 40 years, your clothes didn't wear out and your feet didn't blister or swell. Think about it. Just as a parent disciplines a child, the Lord your God disciplines you for your own good. A little bit later, Numbers, we read, give the following instructions to the people of Israel. Throughout the generations to come, you must make tassels for the hems of your clothing and attach them with a blue cord. When you see the tassels, you will remember to obey all commands of the Lord instead of following your own desires and defiling yourselves as you are prone to do. The tassels will help you remember that you must obey all my commands and be holy to your God. Now there's some modern replacements to those tassels. I don't see very many people running around with tassels on their hands with those. But I see people walking around with crosses. I see fish on the back of cars. There's several different ways that we use to remember. Both Chris and I mentioned that we have fish on the back of the car so that we remember to not be that guy in the middle of rush hour traffic. It helps us to remember. But we're also warned. Deuteronomy 4:9. But watch out! Be careful never to forget what you yourself have seen. Do not let these memories escape from your mind as long as you live. And be sure to pass them on to your children and grandchildren. This passage tells us about our responsibility. And it's got to be pretty important because Moses will repeat it in chapter 6 and again in chapter 11, just in the book of Deuteronomy. Interestingly enough, Jesus says roughly the same thing in Matthew 19:14. Let the children come to me. Don't stop them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to those who are like these children. We have to remind our children, we have to teach our children. And then Peter in Acts chapter 2, verse 39 says, this promise is to you and to your children and even to the Gentiles, all who have been called by the Lord our God. Now if I go all the way back to that passage from Deuteronomy 8, verse 1 says, be careful to avail man's hand given you today. Then you will live and multiply, and you will enter and occupy the land the Lord swore to give your ancestors. Now that was Old Testament stuff. They had promised the land of Canaan. Promised land, land of milk and honey. Put that in context of Christ coming. And it's a different land. The promised land is not a physical place here on this earth. It's heaven. People ask, how do I get to heaven? Trust in the Lord your God as your Lord and Savior. Have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Through that, the Holy Spirit will change you, and you'll be on a path to heaven. Now, throughout the Bible, we also read of monuments and feasts and altars. In Joshua chapter 3, the Israelites are about to enter that promised land that Moses was talking about in that passage. But they had to cross the Jordan River. Now, y'all remember when Moses went out and he parted the Red Sea? God, through Joshua, stops the flow of the river, and a wind comes up and dries the ground, so the hundreds of thousands of Israelites that are crossing can cross on dry land. And then in Joshua chapter 4, we read this. When all the people had crossed the Jordan, the Lord said to Joshua, now choose 12 men, one from each tribe. Tell them, take 12 stones from the very place where the priests are standing in the middle of the Jordan. You see, the priests who were carrying the Ark of the Covenant that had the Ten Commandments in it, they were standing in the middle of that riverbed, that dry riverbed. That's what was allowing the water to stop the people pass through. That Ark of the Covenant was a symbol of God holding that water. Again, he told them, go into the middle of the Jordan in front of the ark of your Lord your God. Each of you must pick up one stone and carry it out on your shoulder, 12 stones in all, one for each of the 12 tribes of Israel. We will use these stones to build a memorial. In the future, your children will ask you, what do these stones mean? Then you can tell them, they remind us that the Jordan River stopped flowing when the Ark of the Lord's Covenant had to cross. These stones will stand as a memorial among the people of Israel forever. That was the first one. And verse 8. So the men did as Joshua had commanded them. They took 12 stones from the middle of the Jordan River, one for each tribe, just as the Lord had told Joshua. They carried them to the place where they camped for the night and constructed the memorial there. Joshua also set up another pile of 12 stones in the middle of the Jordan at the place where the priests who carried the Ark of the Covenant were standing. And they are there to this day. And it's so important that we remember what that memorial was for, that he again, later in chapter 4, explains it all over again to the Israelites, the importance of why they put the 12 stones there. To mark the place of the Lord who allowed them to cross, and to symbolize the 12 tribes of Israel. It's a reminder that God was taking care of them. Now, a little earlier, they were doing their practice for the worship team. Our special guest pianist mentioned something about a song sounding like a camp song. Well, interestingly enough, thinking about God taking care of them reminds me of that little song we learned as little tiny ones. He's got the whole world in his hands. And it's not just Joshua who does these things. Moses did something similar after they crossed the Red Sea when he instituted the Passover feast. I'm not going to go into the Passover feast. I'm going to challenge you to look that up in your Bibles or Google it online. Find out what it is and what it means. In the New Testament, we read that throughout Jesus' ministry, the disciples would remember what the prophets had said in the Old Testament as they watched Jesus do certain things. But when Jesus spoke to them, they kind of scratched their heads like everybody else. Like, what's he talking about? We don't get it. But after he goes to the cross and dies on that cross, and then he comes back, and he meets with them, and the Holy Spirit comes upon them, then it's all the things he said made sense because the Holy Spirit has come down upon them to help them understand. Now today we have lots of monuments. There are countless monuments in Washington, D.C. A new one just opened up in New York, the 9/11 Museum. And there's war memorials. The one that comes to mind the most is the Vietnam Vets Memorial. And something that we're doing for our vets even today is taking those vets on an honor flight to Washington, D.C. I read of one that just a few hours after he returned, he passed away. And we have one here. The one that Sherry put together with loving hands and the pictures that you provided for. Now the one thing that we don't want to do, though, is dwell on the past. Remembering never means to dwell. Oftentimes I hear people say, I wish things could be the way they used to be. Things are moving forward. They can't carry around a dime anymore for the pay phone because I can't find one to put the dime in. Let alone remember the phone number. Dwelling on the past is the kind of attitude that gets you locked in the past, doing the part because you can't accept the way things are now or the way that things will be in the future because things, they change. But remembering the past is still good. The awesome thing about God's Word is that it is absolutely timeless. Applied today, God's Word gives us hope. The Lord's Supper reminds us of what God has done for us. In Luke, Luke writes, Jesus said, "For I will not drink wine again until the kingdom of God has come." In Mark, "I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it new in the kingdom of God." 1 Corinthians, Paul writes what Jesus said, "For every time you eat of this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again." We need to remember what Christ did for us on the cross. Yes, our soldiers have gone out and they have died on the battlefield. And I was, in preparation, I was just looking over some stuff that I had about Lieutenant General Patton. And his pep talk to his troops indicated that only 3% of you are going to die, so get out there and go. He used some more colorful language than that, but that was the extent of his speech. We have God's word. Read it. Get out there and do what it tells us to do. And the most important of those is to love the Lord your God and then love your neighbor as yourself. When you do those two things, everything else comes into focus. Everything else comes into play. Because all the other commandments will come in. You won't have to work with them because the Holy Spirit will work through you. Christ's sacrifice gives us the hope that we read about in the Bible. And it's not a hope of a place we're going to go here. It doesn't necessarily mean things are going to go just all smooth and easy. In fact, he tells us that this life will be difficult. We will experience loss. We will have troubled times. But we're preparing our heavenly forever. That's why it's so important to remember. Now this morning, we're going to go right into communion after the sermon, because that's what this end of the sermon is about, is God's remembering what Christ did for us. Luke puts it this way. "He took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And after supper, he took another cup of wine and said, 'This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you.'" So as we take communion, it's a time of remembering. Again, it's not the meal that we're remembering. The meal is the vehicle of remembrance. Because when he broke the bread, he wasn't just breaking the bread and having a meal. He was using it as a symbol of his broken life, body that would be on the cross. And when he poured the wine into the cup, again, it's not about drinking out of that cup, it's about remembering his blood that he shed for us. As you come forward this morning, remember those who have given their lives so that we can have the freedoms that we have in this country. The freedom to assemble and worship God and not have to hide. And remember what Christ did on the cross for us. Just take the piece of the bread and dip it into the cup. You don't have to be a member here. Just have a relationship with Jesus Christ. If you don't have that relationship, see somebody about that. Pray for them. It's not hard. I'll be down on this side of Nancy, thank you, Julie. Nancy's one of our prayer warriors. Let us go to God and honor him through this session. Father, we thank you for this meeting in Jesus' name. Please come to us.
So
and they're singing that last song, I was looking at the cross, and it's lit up. It's the focal point of the stage. Only God can take this instrument of a horrible death and turn it into something wonderful. And it's empty. It's empty because Christ rose. We need to remember that he went to that cross, died for our sins, and then rose from the dead, which gives us eternal life. Remember that. But also, this weekend, remember those who brought their voices and given their lives. And what they did is so that we can come in here every week, raise the roof for God. Because this isn't for us. We're giving our worship to the Lord, and this helps us remember as a group. It keeps us centered and focused. And it reminds us of that hope. Father, we thank you for that hope. We thank you for that, being able to remember. And Father, we thank you for those who've gone before us and given their lives. And I'm going to turn it back to the worship team.
I'm actually going to sing a couple of verses from America the Beautiful. So if you guys want, please join in.
We're going to start out with a little...
Oh, beautiful, for spacious skies, forever waves of grain, for purple mountains, majesties to shining.